Okay, so we're now having a problem session, and the success of this problem session is going to be determined by how much everybody participates. Okay, so we've heard lots of courses, we've heard lots of current research, but mathematics is not a spectator sport, and we all learn it much better when we do problems. We've also got people from around the world meeting, many for the first time, and we don't want to then have this conference just as a memory, but rather we want to have it as something that we can use to build the future. And the idea for this problem session is that some of us who have got a lot of experience, or some of you even who haven't got much experience, have got lots of maths problems that we want to think about. And there are lots of young people here looking for interesting problems to work on. And if this works well, then we have some problems that different people are going to propose. Some of you are going to be saying, I think I have an idea of how I might be able to solve that. And then we will talk to each other, and in the future, there'll be collaborations going on between people in different parts of the world, and then we all get to know each other better, and the mathematics community gets strengthened. So that's my ideal for how it's going to work. So some people are going to be proposing problems, and I've asked a couple of people to take notes of these problems, and these are going to be typed up and then put onto the web page of the conference. And then together with the contact details that are also on the web page of the conference, if you're interested in this problem, you can then email the person who proposed it, maybe with some ideas or some questions, and perhaps in the future, then you'll have a project together. And so when we come back in 5 years' time, we will hear about many of these things. So that's the idea of where we're going. Now, I know some people have some problems. One of them, who is Bertrand, has to leave very soon. So I'm going to ask him if he'll come first and present his problems. And then we'll move along to other people so that he can shoot off to the bus and have a good trip back.
Thank you. So the problem I wanted to ask is a problem concerning stability theory. So we heard a lot about Kleinian groups acting on three-dimensional hyperbolic space or on CP1. And there is a very great theorem by Sullivan. So maybe let me state really briefly what is the theorem. So this is a theorem about stability of the action of the group on CP1. So it's a kind of so-called the structural stability theorem, which says that so you might take gamma in PGL2C, a Kleinian group. And then we have seen a lot of examples where you can deform the group gamma in a family of groups gamma t depending on some parameters, let's say 0, 1, such that gamma naught is equal to gamma. And then, so Sullivan proposed the following definition of structural stability. He said gamma is structurally stable if for any such family there exists an epsilon, such that the action of gamma epsilon on the Riemann sphere looks exactly the same as the action of gamma on the Riemann sphere up to a homeomorphism. So namely, structural stability means that there exists epsilon such that for any t, there exists, so less than epsilon, there exists a homeomorphism from the Riemann sphere to itself, such that the action, so the gamma action, let's briefly say that the gamma knot action on CP1 is mapped under this homomorphism to the gamma T action here. So what Sullivan proved is that, in fact, the group which are structurally stable are either the rigid group, so those groups that you cannot deform inside PSL2C. So for instance, co-compact lattice in PSL2C, we know that it is rigid by Mostow rigidity theorem. Or if it is not like that, in fact, it is a convex co-compact group. Okay, so the stable group are the rigid group or the convex co-compact group. So we know for a convex co-compact group, we have seen a lot of examples. For instance, quasi-Fuchsian groups, they are structurally stable, namely if you deform, so you have a limit set which is a quasi-circle, and we have seen a lot of talks here where the limit sets were moving continuously, for instance, Mahan's talks. This one. And so my problem.
Sorry.
Yes?
I didn't
understand what the condition of this
is.
It is a homeomorphism. So it satisfies the following. So if you take any gamma in gamma, okay, so then it will satisfy this equation. So if you just follow this, the element in the deformation of your group, so you get from any gamma, you get a gamma t for any t, right? And so the homeomorphism should satisfy such an equation for any gamma. This is what I meant by phi is conjugating the gamma naught action on CP1 to the gamma T action on CP1. Okay. It's continuous. Yeah, right. It's continuous. Continuous family. So maybe you could reformulate exactly the same thing as looking at the whole the deformation space of the group. No, just for all. So the Sullivan theorem says that if for all families, possible families, you have this structural stability, then in fact either you are a rigid group or convex co-compact group, right? So the problem is not quite a question. So the problem I would like to know to address it. I think it's difficult, but still, in fact, I have not. I don't think there is any theorem like that in for representation in higher dimensions. Namely, we have seen a lot of such representations, for instance, in complex hyperbolic groups or in let's say SLN. R or SNC for n bigger than or equal to 3. And I think that would be really great to develop a kind of stability theory to see if such theorems could be true. For instance, so the question, is it true that if you have stability in this sense, structural stability in this sense, then in fact your group is anosov in the sense of Labourie, etc. This kind of thing. I don't know, but it's possible. It would be really interesting to have to answer these questions, even in particular cases, I think, even in SL3 C or something. Okay, yes. So this is, I think this is part of the problem to define the thing, but you can look at some action on projective space or flag varieties. I don't know. For anosov representations, I think you have stability on all these flag varieties, probably. It is table. If the converse is true. So Gisha told you that the converse should be true in this context? But I think that... So the question that Nicolas was addressing is on which... So first question was on which space do you act? Do you see... I mean, will you detect stability? So here... It was P1C, but if you take a subgroup of SL3C, for instance, you could look at P2C or flag varieties. It's not clear what is a good space to look at. So I agree, this is part of the problem. But and then Nicolas said that even if you take, for instance, ANOSOF representation, so we expect it is stable because ANOSOF system in dynamical system. Are always structurally stable. So we expect some structural stability properties of ANOSOF representation, but Nicolas said that it is not even clear that it is true. So maybe, of course, we should look at... In fact, I have not thought about that. So, but I'm sure that there are some stability properties for ANOSOF representations, because I'm sure of that. For instance, you can restrict the... You can make a weaker definition of... stability only on the limit set. And for ANOSOF representation, I think this is quite clear that this will be true. I don't know. I mean, this is more a problem than a question, a precise question, I think. But this is really interesting, I think, to think about these kind of things. Okay. Thank you.
Are there any more questions about Bertrand's problem? Okay. Well, I've got Todd waiting in the wings.
I don't have to go first. All right. Some of these are actually problems. Some of them are more directions to go in, as it were. All right, I'll put my initials by them. Okay, I almost gave Sir a heart attack because I can't tell the difference between a torus, a three-hole torus, and a three-hole sphere and a one-hole torus. I don't know why. But on the one-hole torus, if with a cusp, you can look at McShane's identity. Where is this? Sir told me to do this. Right? Oh yeah, I remember this. Okay, it's sum of 1/e to the length of a simple closed geodesic plus 1 is equal to 1, right? And in a recent paper by, it's on the archives, by Charette and Goldman, they differentiate this. And if you remember, for those of you who weren't here, but for the students, if you remember what I was talking about, when you take the derivative, when you're expanding, what are alphas? Those alphas, the Margulis invariants, right? They're derivatives of lengths, right? You're expanding lengths. So you can differentiate this thing, and you get some new sum is equal to some alpha because you're opening up the cusp, right? And so you get another identity here. Okay, so the question is, you go over and you see Sertan, and you say, how many different identities do you have? There's not just one, there's like bushels of them. He has them growing all over his house. And you say, I'll take another one of those identities and do the same thing. Differentiate it, see what you get. So it's a nice, I think this is an easy problem to do. It's a doable problem. See what happens. So try... Charette Goldman on another McShane type identity. All right, so that's the first problem. I think it's kind of a nice, easy problem. I think it's I don't know if it's a thesis problem, but it's a nice thing to write up and see what you get. Maybe you have a nice organized way of looking at it like Sir does on all these McShane's identities too. All right, so we'll do another one. Well, you're going to look at differentiate means look at an affine deformation. Affine deformation. Okay, so you take this torus, right? You have a surface, and then you look at an affine deformation, and that is differentiating that's going to take the derivative of the lengths. And whenever you take the derivative of the lengths, you get these alphas, these Margulis invariants. So this sum is going to have, I mean, I could almost write it, but I don't, I'd probably screw it up. But it's going to have lengths of closed geodesics, and for the affine deformation that you have, it's going to have an alpha for it too. So it's going to have, this is going to have lengths, it's going to be a function of lengths and alpha of gamma. So for a particular affine deformation. McShane's, I don't know the... Charette Goldman? Yeah, look at, sir, do you have some references? No, I mean, but like other identities. Yeah, you're going to see a bunch of them. He's going to do a bunch of them. They grow. I don't know how. They just push up. Yeah, I'm sorry about that. I got ahead of myself. We should have done this afterwards. All right, there's another, I'm just versioning shill today. A long time ago, I don't know, a long time ago, she looked at, just a year ago, she looked at ideal affine deformations. Of ideal triangle groups. So in this case, you have three geodesics, which meet an infinity. You now draw their associated closed geodesics, and you say, now you have three lines. You put it into R21. And you have three lines in general position. I think something like that. Maybe, I don't know if they cross or whatever. And now you look at reflections in each one of those lines. Okay, reflections on each one of those lines are going to preserve a crooked plane. They're going to preserve a bunch of crooked planes. The vertex, this is going to be the spine. There's that unique space-like line lying on the crooked plane. They're going to define a crooked plane, but you can put the vertex different places. So you have three choices for your vertexes, but it's rather rigid because you can only move in those three lines, okay? So there are examples of Charette's where she shows that there are ideal affine defs of ideal triangle groups. Which act properly on the affine space E21. I should say it's E21 up there. Doesn't matter. Okay, do not have a crooked fundamental domain. Okay, and the idea here would be to try to find a nice way to domains, kind of like when John Parker and Bill Goldman were talking about triangle groups. You know, Rich Schwartz, you had a conjecture of how far you could push this. Can you dimple? Rich Schwartz came along and dimpled the the spinal spheres. So can you dimple the crooked planes in a nice way to create a nice fundamental domain? In general, I talked to Virginie about this, and she said, well, you should just redo that whole paper, just because we have new techniques and everything. So we're expanding the techniques. So this is to find nice domains. Okay? They're going to have possibly pieces of these crooked fundamental domains, but they're going to be some, maybe it's going to be dimpled, maybe there's going to be another way to think about them. But you can't, it's much more rigid than the usual case, because you have to have your crooked planes on the vertices on these lines, so you can't move them off these lines. All right? I'm not done. None of them are good, but we'll get, no, this one's good. This is in the same vein. If you remember, again, people who weren't here, but hopefully you've heard enough of these things that you'll get used to this. But, in R21, or E21 if you want to call it, the crooked plane conjecture holds. Okay, and that means that every free properly discontinuous action on E21, you can find a domain bounded by how many crooked planes you need. Okay? Yeah. Sorry. Yeah? Oh, this is in E2. Oh, I haven't gotten to the next question, right? But see, this one was about free. This is about free. This is for free actions. This is the problem, because these are not free. You're going to have a lot of fixed points here, okay? But you do have a finite cover. But you could say, well, what are those going to look like? So, you know, is there a nice one? Yeah. In some ways, it's not so shocking. But in other ways, it'd be nice to see these. And see what rigidity you have on this, or see what conformation you have. But in this one, so this is what, this is from the notorious DGK, since Fanny left, I can say that. Did you, anybody heard of the note? Oh, that's right, darn. they're notorious, they're terrible. But also by the notorious DGK, that in ADS 3, the crooked plane conjecture fails. They show examples, but all of their examples are about doing these lines and moving them on the hyperbolic surface. So they create, as the last thing I did in my lecture was I took a line in this, and I built a crooked plane. Well, they look at how lines are moving on these crooked on the surface, and they relate that to the crooked planes. So the question is, again, can you find a nice fundamental domain for these things where the crooked plane conjecture doesn't hold? Okay, again, same. Can you find a nice way to a nice domain in ADS. Probably related to crooked planes, but slightly different. All right. Okay, so I'm not quite done. All right, there was a throwaway line that I told you that I said in my course. So, I'm not going to do that one because I'm not sure about that one. So the next one, we're going to erase Bertrand's because it's too crazy for words. Yeah, he's gone. So I can say is what I want about him. Now, what can I say about Bertrand? He's too nice. Darn. Okay. So the the natural objects that appear in, well, the natural things that appear in R2-1 don't appear in R3-1, right? Because in R3-1, you don't have 1 as an eigenvalue, so you don't get free proper actions, right? So you might look for the next place where this occurs. And strangely enough, the next place where this kind of Margulis space-time might occur, or a Margulis space-like time, like thing might occur, is not in R3-2 because of some weird thing with the alphas, but in R4-3. So, okay, so look at R4-3, and of course now we can go crazy, R4-3, R6, 5, etc., etc., etc. Okay, so in these spaces, these are real, don't ask me what this means, but they're real split. A generic element will look like a generic element of SO 4-3 will be conjugate to something like 1 lambda, lambda inverse, lambda 1 inverse, lambda 2, lambda 2 inverse. These are all real numbers. It's identical, and you have these coming in pairs, kind of like these Anosov representations, but they're a little bit more general than the Anosov ones that Francois gets, I think. All right, and so in all of this stuff, you can define alpha, right? You can define alpha. So, and there exists free proper actions. Okay, so what you might want to say is there a geometric version of this? Because we went a lot further than just the algebraic methods of Margulis and stuff. And Margulis and Seufer and Abels have done a lot of this. But there is a geometric version by, and I'm going to, please try to get this name right for me. Smilga? Is that the way we, recent student of Yves Benoit, and now he's at Strasbourg? Is he, yeah, he's, what? Oh, he's at Yale, okay, that's right. Okay, he created these, a kind of crooked plane in 4-3 space. But the crooked plane that he created was a little flabby, so you can't calculate with it. So the question is, can you find something a little bit more rigid or change Smilga's approach so that you can get a little bit more rigid to get these things in R4-3 to figure out what the parameterization, the moduli space looks like, okay? So you alter Smilga's approach to get to understand the deformation space. I've thought about this on and off, and it hurts my head because, you know, I only think on every, it only works on every other Thursday, and then I can only do in dimension 4, and I can't get up to dimension 7. It's very confusing. Okay, there's another related one to this, and this will be my last one, thank God, as you all are saying. Get me back to some real hyperbolic geometry crap or complex hyperbolic geometry stuff. And the last one is Auslander's conjecture. Fanny talked about this. Auslander's conjecture it states that if M is affinely flat and compact. I'm writing it out because that's the most important part. All of our examples have been non-compact examples. Then pi 1 of m, by the way, you need complete 2. I'm sorry, we'll put complete here. Complete, you always need complete. I don't know. The physicists are actually interested in non-complete things, but we like complete things. So that then the question is, then pi 1 is, I think it's virtually solvable. I think that's the, right. So this is true, it's proven in dimension less than or equal to 6. And there's a problem, and where's the problem? One of the problems is in, what about 4-3, the 4-3 signature, okay? What about 4-3? This signature right here, these manifolds and higher manifolds. And is there an idea of how to figure out, with the if you're forced to have compactness, if you're forced to get compactness, can you get rid of free groups? And that's the question. All right, I'm done. Yeah, there's reasons for that, and I forget all the reasons. A big deal is eigenvalue 1. But that doesn't throw away all of them, but it throws away a lot of them. That you want something who's, because. There's a bunch of the references to less than or equal to 6. I'll probably be off on this, but look at the papers by Abels, Margulis, and Seufer. I think they discuss it in detail and they go through it. Also, Tomanoff might have some of this too, so you can look at, I don't know how much he has, but Tomanoff has some of these. And he's using very algebraic approaches here. Tomanov does, but they all are using, all of this approach, the approach that they're trying to do with R4-3 is really back to the original Margulis paper, which is really a lot of estimates and a lot of angles that are just wacky. So, hard to feel.
More questions? Okay.
I killed the room.
Oh. Good. Well, Pepe tells me he has something up his very chic sleeve. I can't say that.
Okay. Thanks. Is it just the one very basic problem? Elementary? So consider gamma, discrete subgroup in PU 2-1. Okay, so it acts on CP2, preserving the hyperbolic 2 space, which is a ball. If gamma is a lattice, then it acts minimally on the boundary of hyperbolic space, the ideal boundary, which is this trisphere. So in the trisphere, every orbit is dense. And then it's an exercise, very easy, using projective geometry, to see that that implies it acts minimally on CP2 minus the complex hyperbolic space. Okay? So now the question is, what if it is not a lattice? Okay? What, suppose now that you have an action here, now if gamma is not a lattice, then you will have a fundamental domain hitting, really, in the interior of the ball, hitting the sphere at infinity with a fundamental domain for the action on the sphere. And then outside, you don't know what happens. The region of say, equicontinuity can have infinitely many components. You don't know what happens. Very hard to control in general. But let me say, let's assume that let omega not be the connected omega not equal connected component of the equicontinuity region that contains H to C. Okay? So the this action is equicontinuous in the interior of the ball. Because of this, that's extending to some set around. So the action is, the observed problem is study H, study omega naught and the quotient omega naught divided by the action. So for example, can we describe a fundamental domain? And so on. Yeah. Yes. No, on the limit set in the boundary. Yeah. The number of connected components? There are. We have examples. There are examples in which you can have 1, 2, 3, 4, or infinitely many. I don't know if that's always the case. Or that this quotient is compact? Should be, yeah. So it's a compact manifold that contains a submanifold, an open submanifold, which is complex hyperbolic. And then you have a projective structure on the compact one. No, you can. No, Angel, can you have compact quotients in the setting? Yeah, right. We know the answer, but I don't know. I don't know. Yeah. Sí. Si tienes el contexto que planteé, puedes tener un cociente compacto. No? Okay. No, so sorry. For you cannot have a compact quotient. Yeah. Because we gave the classification of the compact quotients that you have. And then looking at that classification, you can see which kind of open sets you can have. And then the corresponding groups and so on. No idea. It's dimension 3 is wild. Okay. Thank you.
Well, as the other three organizers have all presented problems, I'm going to present some problems. and then I'm going to open it to everybody else for more problems. So the broad general idea would be, if I've got S, a surface, finite type, and I've got pi 1 of S, fundamental group, then study the representations of pi 1 of S into PU 2, 1. And the geometry. So that's a very broad theme. There's various things already known. I've got a survey paper a few years ago with Plattis where we gathered together many things, but there are still many things that are unknown. So one thing that you might like to try to do, so problem one, would be see how far you can go in the direction that Mahan was talking about Cannon-Thurston maps, convergence of limit sets, and so forth. So complex hyperbolic version of, well, I'm just going to say Mahan's talk. So this would be limit sets, Cannon-Thurston, etc. So, I mean, yes? That's going to be my next question, right? So, I mean, I didn't mean the sophisticated part of his talk. I meant the baby part of his talk, okay? So let's just think about, can you get this basic thing of do you have this Cannon-Thurston map in it? Does that exist? And so forth. And if you have a sequence of groups, how do things behave? So a second question could be, what happens as you go to the boundary? Yeah? My belief, which I have tentatively stated as a conjecture, is that you always get pinching. I.e., curve going to or a cusp or something. So curve going to a cusp. Or I don't know what rank the cusp would be. Yeah? If that's true, which curves can you pinch? How many can you pinch at the same time? And which ones can you pinch at the same time? Sorry? Right? Right? Yeah, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, yeah, it's going to be very different from...
Oh, it's going to be... Yeah, 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 yeah. So then, three, who or how many can you pinch? So Pierre and I have a one-parameter family of three punctured spheres, where you have seven curves pinched, but we don't know whether these are discrete or not. We're just that we have seven conjugacy classes of parabolic elements. Can you do better? Can you get eight? It's in the Almora proceedings. Okay, so my belief would be that somehow your boundary of your quasi-Fuchsian space has got some sort of polyhedral structure where you would have codimension one facets where one curve is pinched and these intersect along codimension two curves where two are pinched. Yeah? So the boundary of the set of discrete and faithful representations. So you would a point would be on the boundary if it had a neighborhood where it was discrete and faithful, where there was some for any neighborhood you take, there is a non-discrete or non-faithful point in that neighborhood. So it's where you might expect elliptic maps, but you could be going to the boundary for a more complicated way. Construct an example. Yeah, I don't know of any examples. It's completely different from the classical case.
But you do have some results to that effect, right? In that there are sort of strata and the boundary.
All the examples that we know where we can go to the boundary, it's because somebody has become pinched. Okay? And so one of my underlying reasons here, in SU21, being parabolic is a codimension one condition. Whereas in SL2C, being parabolic is a codimension two condition. And therefore, if you were to just look at your space of representations, which is this big, however it would be 8G minus 8 dimensional space, and you then just looked at the locus where every word is parabolic, which is just solving an algebraic equation, so that's a real algebraic variety, yeah? Then that certainly those points would have a neighborhood where there was a non-discrete representation because they have elliptic elements in the neighborhood. But does that actually cut out the boundary, or is there a smaller set? Can you go to the boundary for some different reason? So if I look at my space of representations, no, just all the representations, and now I look at, I choose an element in my group, and then I look at the hypersurface, real hypersurface, where that is parabolic. On one side it's going to be loxodromic, on the other side it's going to be elliptic. And so if any of those points were discrete and faithful, they would be in the boundary because they would have an elliptic close by them. So if I just start off and I do the absolutely stupid thing of looking at this big space, which I can't possibly imagine even on alternate Thursdays, and I cut out all this locus where all of these people are parabolic, and look at what's left. Is that my discrete and faithful representations? I mean, another fact is that in even dimensional hyperbolic spaces, to be non-discrete, you must have an infinite order elliptic if you're Zariski dense. Absolutely, absolutely. So it should be a mapping class group invariant polyhedral. When I say polyhedral, I mean in a very, very loose sense. Yeah. Okay, so. I don't think you can represent a hyperbolic three-manifold group into SU2-1. You can into SU3-1, but I think it's not possible to do it into SU2-1. Well, anyway. I'm running between the two of you. I hope the rest of the audience isn't bored, yeah? Sorry.
You had these Rochi examples, right?
Right, yeah.
So you have examples of Whitehead-Lee complements being represented.
Not faithfully.
Now, those guys have a fiber. I mean, those are fiber three manifolds.
Yes.
So what Nicola is talking about is, if you have a representation,
yes,
where the fiber is represented faithfully,
yes, then that would work, but I don't think that happens. Yeah. Pierre, does he? Okay, he's busy. Maybe another slightly more vague question. So far there's very little in the way of analysis. When I say analysis, I'm thinking of how alphas and bears develop the classical theory of quasi-Fuchsian groups. There is a notion of quasi-conformal mappings on the S3 or quasi-conformal mappings with respect to this CR structure. They're not good enough to get all of your deformations, because quotient of a vertical Heisenberg translation and the quotient of a non-vertical Heisenberg translation are not quasi-conformally conjugate. So if you have such a path of representations, then you couldn't realize this by quasi-conformal mappings. So there are good things. So I ought to say here, you should see Loftin and McIntosh, where they have been introduced cubic differentials and certain differential equations, which is a good starting point. And I won't go into that, but that's a good starting point. But it only tells you a small subset of these deformations. Can you push this all the way to the boundary in some way? How about quasi-regularity? Yeah. I don't know. I mean, these are sort of, I haven't really thought about these things. Yeah? Yeah?
Do you know anything about the topology of
Like
the
topology of?
So if you look at the convex hook and macro.
Yes.
Do you know anything about the topology?
The topology of that space?
Not
off the top of my head. The question was, do I know anything about the topology of the space of of convex code compact representations. So what I do know is that your manifold is going to be a disk bundle over your surface. And so you have an Euler number associated to that, and different Euler numbers can arise. So you would have a different component for every Euler number, because that's a topological invariant. In particular, there are examples of Ananin and Gusevsky, I think, where it's actually a product. So you have Euler number zero. There are also examples where you have a wild knot. So a little bit like some of the things we were hearing from Gabriella last week. And so those cannot be in the same component as something with a topological circle boundary. So I think there are many, many islands of representations, and I don't know what the shape of each island would be. What are the examples? So I think we were just talking about surface groups there, but yeah. So you want other groups other than surface groups? Well, off the top of my head, I was thinking surface groups there, but no. So anyway, so there's lots of questions there. Finally, one of my favorite questions, and I've been asking this question for around at least 10 years now, probably more like 15 years. So Gusevsky and I and Alicia and people and various other things have constructed examples of continuous paths of representations of punctured surface groups. That interpolate this is from people who were around last week, R Fuchsian and C Fuchsian. Okay, so I've got a path here at this end. My group is R Fuchsian. At this end, it's C Fuchsian. The limit set of all of these is going to be a topological circle, and its Hausdorff dimension should vary probably real analytically with respect to my parameter if I've set it up correctly. So then we've got, I want to think about the Hausdorff dimension of the limit set of gamma t. At this end, the Hausdorff dimension is 1. It's a round circle. The way you measure Hausdorff dimension in using this CR geometry that we've heard about means, this is the strange thing when you first see it, that here the Hausdorff dimension is 2. Because you need to have quadratically many little balls to cover your line. So I have a real analytic function interpolating between 1 and 2. I know that as soon as I leave here, it's strictly bigger than 1, because there's a version of Bowen's theorem due to Chengbo Yue and various other versions I've seen. What does this function look like? Is it monotone? I mean, in particular, do I approach 2 from below? If I approach 2 from above, what's the maximum value and why? I think so, yes. Yeah. So, yes, mine's just pointed out there's some papers, I think Colette said it bounded away from three, that chimes with my memory as well. And this is certainly an application of, can you get good analysis techniques to work in this case? My guess is it's probably going to approach two from below, but just because I can't imagine why one group in the middle should have a higher Hausdorff dimension than the others. It just seems to be, that seems to be a sort of monstrous thing, but my guess is it could well approach two quite shallowly. Well, the wild limit sets, I don't know what the Hausdorff dimension of those would be. So that's another question, okay? See, there's questions and questions and questions, and they're keeping going on. But this is a general area where I think it's very fertile, there's lots and lots of questions, and if you know the real hyperbolic techniques well for any of these questions, then there's a good chance that something will move across into the complex hyperbolic world. And of course, you can always combine this with Pepe's question and say, well, okay, let's just embed this in CP3 and see what happens there. Okay? So that's the end of my questions.
Just a quick answer to your question. If you take this quotient, if you have an open set with a group which acts, say, without torsion-free, so that this is a manifold. This is a manifold which automatically is going to have a projective structure. And the compact complex manifolds with a projective structure are classified. They are either complex hyperbolic or complex affine. Then you only have to see that in this setting, you cannot have something which is complex affine.
Okay. So, are there more problems? Todd is nominating Soren from afar. So, do you have some questions?
So, this is exactly the question I asked at the end of my talk about completeness of some GX structure, but let me insist then. Sorry about this. I will be brief. So this is somehow the complex version of results which are known in the Lorentz setting about completeness of compact manifolds locally modeled. Say the easiest, let's take the simplest example here would be G would be the complex Euclidean group acting on C3, or here G would be SL2 of C times SL2 of C acting on X, which is SL2 of C by left and right translations and preserving the Killing quadratic form. So they are complexified version of the ADS3 for which Klingler proved completeness. And one interesting feature here is that you have some pseudo-Riemannian metric which is preserved. The real part of this holomorphic Riemannian metric is a pseudo-Riemannian metric of signature here 3-3, or in dimension n, it would be n-n, for which, for example, the flat case here is a special case of Marcus conjecture, since you put on the blackboard Auslander conjecture. Maybe I will recall people, Marcus conjecture. Which say that compact flat affine manifolds with a parallel volume are complete. So here, in fact, X is Rn and G is SLnR, semi-direct product with Rn. So this is an old conjecture, maybe 50 years old now. Affine manifolds are complete as soon as you have a volume which is preserved by the holonomy. It's known to be true if you replace here SLn by the linear group, preserving a Lorentz quadratic form. So flat Lorentz manifolds on compact manifolds are known to be complete by Carrier theorem. But for pseudo-Riemannian orthogonal group, for pseudo-Riemannian metric, this is still an open question. And the point here is that if you look to those complex manifolds locally modeled on these complex affine spaces, you have a feature here which is specifically complex geometry, comes from specifically from complex geometry. You have complex curves which are geodesics. So one could try to understand the geometry of these Riemann surfaces. Of course, they have a translation structure, as all geodesics have. And if you want to have compact manifold, you can projectivize the tangent bundle, so you get this holomorphic foliation by Riemann surfaces in the projectivized tangent bundle. And these Riemann surfaces have some complex affine structure because it comes from the translation structure of the geodesic, which was, and you take quotients by homotacies. So you have complex affine structure along these geodesics. Namely, these geodesics cannot be copy of P1 of C. So in the classification of Riemann surfaces, they are either covered by the unitary disk or by C. So a first step would be to show that these geodesics are parabolic. They are covered by C. And here there are tools coming from the theory of holomorphic foliations, tools which were part of them were developed by Brunella or Kandel. If you assume you have too many leaves covered by the disk, you can uniformized by the disk in families, this geodesic, so you have something which is negatively curved, which would be somehow in contradiction with the flatness of your holomorphic Riemannian metric. So this would be an extra tool to be used here in the complex setting and solve a baby part of the Marcus conjecture. And also I recall that Tolozan have examples showing that if you have this kind of GX structures which are uniformized, if you have quotients of open sets in the model which are compact, the open set will be all of the model. So it goes into the direction of Marcus conjecture and shows that in the second case, those which are complete, those of GX structures which are complete, they will form a closed set. And results of Fanny Castle, Guerito, Guichard, and Anna Vinard show that these GX structures which are complete form also an open set. So there is those which are complete in the deformation space is a finite, is an union of connected components. So maybe there are exotic ones, but far away from the examples we know. So this would be a question. And sorry, I already asked it in my talk, but I wanted to be more precise.
Thank you. Okay. Have we got some more questions?
Yeah, so I think commensurators and had come up in Ruth's talk, and limit sets have been sort of functioning all over the place. So this is a certain question which, yeah. So let's look at the general context. So G is now semi-simple Lie group. P, what I think the minimal parabolic of such that, so G mod P is the Furstenberg boundary. So what you should be thinking of is, so very concrete example is G equal to hyperbolic plane cross hyperbolic plane, and then G mod P is the circle at infinity cross the circle at infinity. So even in this context, all this stuff about limit sets does go through. So if you have gamma contained in G being Zariski dense, then lambda gamma contained in G mod P is the smallest non-empty closed invariant set. Okay? All right. So, I mean, if you feel like thinking of rank one, that's fine. If you feel like thinking higher rank, that's also fine. All right. So, there's this theorem which Ruth had mentioned during her talk. This is a characterization of arithmeticity. Gamma contained in G is arithmetic, lattice gamma contained in G is arithmetic if and only if the commensurator of gamma is dense in G. So this is by Margulis. Okay? Now, how about gamma contained in G, Zariski dense, but not a lattice? So what I mean by how about this? Commensurator of gamma, can commensurator of gamma be dense? So this has to do with another topic that has been coming up in relatively recent times. It's sort of sold under the terminology thin groups. And that's sort of a little offensive to Kleinian groupies because we've been dealing with thin groups all our lives, okay? So it just says that you take some gamma, which is Zariski dense, which is of infinite core volume, that's called a thin group. So this has been sort of a topic that has been discussed and sort of promoted largely by, I mean, started off by Sarnak, and now a whole bunch of people in the Lie groups world are talking about it. Question, what are commensurators of these things, okay? And so here's a proposition that if the limit set of gamma contained in G mod P, the Furstenberg boundary, is not equal to G mod P, then so this is question star, let's say. So then answer to star is no. Okay? So if the limit set is not everything, then one can conclude that the commensurator is indeed discrete. Yeah? So what we were dealing with in the morning today, and lots of people have dealt with, are the case where only in the three-dimensional PSL2C case, thin groups with limit set the whole sphere. Are there examples in other contexts? Okay, so the finitely generated, yeah. So what's an example? So let's give a very concrete version of this example in dimension 2, PSL2R, where it's not known. So dimension 2, PSL2R, and you sort of look at the simplest possible group where this proposition does not apply. So gamma naught is equal to, say, SL2Z, okay, or PSL2Z. And gamma is normal in gamma naught of infinite index. So this implies that the limit set of gamma is the entire circle at infinity. Any normal subgroup has the same limits as the whole group. Yeah? Is commensurator of gamma equal to gamma naught? We don't know. Okay? So even a very, very specific example, I mean, in no example do we know this. Okay? Because these are infinitely generated groups. So for example, you can take SL2Z, pass to a congruent subgroup so that you have homology. Yeah, so you take the second congruent subgroup, pass to its commutator subgroup. Okay, so that's sort of, I mean, very functorial, nice algebraic constructions. I mean, as arithmetic as you can get. Yeah, but so e.g. gamma is equal to gamma 2, gamma 2, gamma p, gamma p, where this is the pth congruence subgroup of PSL2Z. So, but this is infinite index. It's sort of as arithmetic as you can get in the infinite covolume world. We don't know whether its commensurator is SL2Z or not.
Okay, good. We are due to be having our final talk in 2 or 3 minutes' time. So I would suggest that we have a two-minute break. But it's clear that there are lots and lots of problems. If you have a problem that you want to ask and you didn't get the opportunity, then please can you write it up and send it to us, and we will include it in the list of problems. And hopefully we can, if we had somebody young and dedicated, perhaps we could actually maintain a problems page for the group around us. I am not young and dedicated to that sort of thing, but perhaps there's one of you who is interested in that. That would be a fantastic thing if we could have a problems page for people who are interested in the sorts of things at this conference. Okay, good.